Today I have the pleasure of speaking with Amanda Lacaze from Lynas. How are you today, Amanda?
Good, thanks, Tracy.
So everyone's talking about the U.S.-China trade wars presently, and of course this affects rare earths frontline. Can you tell us what this really means to the overall market?
So I think on balance it's actually doing the market some good and also not helping the market right now as well. But I think that having major international economies speaking about rare earths is a positive thing. I think that the rare earths market is quite a small market. And so if you're, for example, the CEO of a car company, you're not going to think about rare earths if you're looking at your bill of materials. In a $25,000 bill of materials, rare earths may only be a couple of hundred dollars. What you are going to do is care about rare earths when you can't get them because you can't put your car on the road. So I think that the discussions that are going on about rare earths, which are precipitated by the trade tensions, is actually good because it causes a focus on our industry. On the other hand, anything that distorts markets is ultimately not good for markets. So it's a bit of a double-edged sword, and we think that the increased interest in rare earths, however, at this time, is probably net positive. And I think that a lot of outside China markets and customers are thinking very seriously about how do they secure their future needs.
Of course, the media headlines, Amanda, are rare earths. I'm getting, you know, emails nonstop. The views and the traction on our website, for instance, are not reflective of actually the size of the actual industry. So I am assuming that the U.S. government, for instance, would be reaching out to you for advice. Can you confirm that you've had talks with them?
So we engage with governments and we engage with customers all over the world. I think the last time that there was a crisis, the famous crisis of 2011, you had interesting responses. In Europe, they set up a research alliance which studied rare earth supply chains. In the US, they launched the legal case in the WTO. In Japan, they funded Lynas. And the result of that is that the Japanese rare earths processing market and consumption has increased by about 60% since 2012. And the growth in the market has directly tracked Lynas market share growth in Japan. And so I think that what you see is that where you have secure and reliable supply, that you have a strong and growing market. So we talk to governments and customers all over the world, but what we talk about is it's not just about what you dig out of the ground. It's about the whole of the rare earth supply chain, and you need to be thinking about that as you're putting policy settings.
Well, I think you've, of course, drawn our audience's attention to a topic we've often covered, which is that there's a lot to rare earths, and the technology for extracting them, of course, is a major component. Would you like to comment on this? You know, because we're seeing a lot of news media about, of course, speculative rare earth resources that are a far distance away from being extracted from the ground.
Sure. Well, we often say that in our business we have three really significant things that set us apart. The first is our Mt Weld resource, which is recognized as the premier resource throughout the world. And it is so high grade. It is a true tier one resource, high grade, long life. It is so high grade that with some of it, we don't even need to put it through the concentrator before we process it. The second thing is that we do have the benefit of being first market. We are the only non-Chinese miner and processor of any scale. But the third, and the point that you're making, Tracy, is that you can't just pick up a textbook and start processing rare earths tomorrow. Every resource is different. Every resource has its challenges. And actually, the Chinese who are true experts in rare earths processing are careful not to export their technology. And so for us now, we've been running a rare earth separation plant here in Malaysia for over 6 years, and we have developed IP within our business with respect to how to separate those materials. So it is not easy, and we have the scars on our back. And it's quite funny, our operations manager was asked not long ago, well, if you had the chance to do it again, what would you do differently? And he said, I wouldn't do it. So that gives you a sense of the level of complexity and challenge which is involved.
And of course, with all of the increased interest in sustainability related issues, can you tell me whether or not the Americans will be including Australian resources in some of their mandates to have non-Chinese sourced critical materials like rare earths?
I believe so, Tracy. And there's been a number of communiques, joint communiques between the Australian and the US governments, and most recently just actually he's still there at present in the US, our Prime Minister Scott Morrison. And as part of some of the comments which have been made, and particularly in the joint interview that occurred out of the White House with the President and Prime Minister Morrison, they referenced the fact that the two countries would continue to work closely and work even more closely on the supply of critical minerals and rare earths in particular. In addition to that, you will have seen that we announced in May a memorandum of understanding working with Blue Line in Texas, your home state, for the establishment of a rare earths separation plant there. Initially, that will be focused on heavy rare earths, which are used in even smaller quantities than the light rare earths, but which are critical in their various applications.
So we've noticed also an increase, of course, in some of the share volumes, but not really the share prices overall. Do you see this actually translating to an increase in rare earths, say like the run-up we had in 2011 and 2012?
So we had a small spike in price when the sort of trade tensions first really got a lot of coverage, and after Xi Jinping went to visit the magnet factory in southern China. But the prices dropped back, and I guess this is what I would say is the other piece of the trade tensions is, whilst it's a good thing that we have focus on rare earths, on the other hand, particularly inside China, it has had an effect on business confidence. And so the Chinese economy has slowed. And I think when we talk to our Chinese friends, that I sense a difference in the way that they're thinking from the way that they have before. And so the market demand in China has been relatively flat. I think there's many months now where the automotive demand in China has actually declined. And so I think that's translating to still relatively soft prices. The good news for us is that demand outside China remains very strong. And so whilst the price isn't where we would like it to be, it's certainly still a fair way north of where it was 2 or 3 years ago when we were really living hand to mouth in terms of cash.
Well, Amanda, thank you so much for providing us with some insight into what's happening with the geopolitical issues on rare earths presently. Thank you.
Thanks, Tracy.